to the Vatican, his atrocities were described. He killed some by breaking them under the wheels of carts. Others, stripped of their clothes, were skinned alive. Others placed upon stakes or roasted on red-hot coals. Others punctured with stakes, piercing their heads, their breasts, their buttocks, and the middle of their entrails, with the stake emerging from their mouths. The Transylvanians tried to take refuge behind the secure walls of monasteries, but nothing could stop the bloodthirsty Vlad Dracul. It was during this time that this famous scene occurred, with Vlad dining at a table amongst the impaled bodies of his countless victims. By late 1461, Dracula, unquestionably in command of his homeland, decided to do battle with his old enemies, the Turks. In a series of surprise raids, and with the advanced stories of his treacherous ways, spreading panic throughout the Turkish forces, Vlad secured victory after victory. Short period of time, he had achieved the impossible. Leaving a bloody trail of conquered Turkish villages behind them, Vlad and his troops reached the Black Sea. This was a highly symbolic accomplishment, and those who choose to remember only those victories still call Vlad Dracula a hero. But Dracula's success was short-lived. Taking the matter somewhat more seriously, the Turkish Sultan sent 200,000 troops into Transylvania. Against these odds, Dracula was forced to retreat towards Wallachia. He had no choice but to return to his castle, but Vlad wasn't alone. The Sultan sent a battery of troops after him, and Dracula's mighty castle was destroyed. Dracula, however, escaped through a secret tunnel with a few friends and fled to Hungary. 12 years later, Vlad Dracula was finally killed by the Turks at this spot, Snagov. The Sultan ordered that Vlad's head be returned to him as proof of his demise. The monks at Snagov buried Dracula's headless body in their monastery. Some say he lives on. Truthfully, I am appalled at the treatment dealt him at the hands of today's Western culture. It must sadden him to be reduced to a mathematical puppet for preschoolers, a gaudy waxen caricature in cheap chambers of horrors. Why, his name has even been associated with a sugar-saturated breakfast cereal. This is an insult to Vlad the Impaler, hero to his people, and the very image of Satan to his enemies. The true, terrifying history of Dracula is found in no less a shrine than the British Museum. This in itself stands as a tribute to this master politician, statesman, warrior, and all-round benevolent dictator. Of course, every head of state has been prone to excess, and every head of state has his own peculiar tastes, whether for jelly beans, peanuts, or blood. 400 years after his death, Dracula found new life. It was Bram Stoker, an Irish novelist, who first introduced the Dracula legend to English literature. His research into the historical Vlad Dracula was painstaking, if you'll permit the pun. It was Stoker who changed Vlad from a bloodthirsty prince to a bloodthirsty vampire. Listen to Stoker's vivid description of a first meeting with the Count in his 1897 novel, Dracula. The driver suddenly turned down a narrow road, which turned sharply to the right. Soon we were hemmed in with trees, which in places arched right over the roadway, till we passed as though through a tunnel. Just then, the moon, sailing through the black clouds, appeared behind the jagged crest of a beetling pine-clad rock. And by its light, I saw around us a ring of wolves with white teeth and lolling red tongues, with long sinewy limbs and shaggy hair. All at once, the wolves began to howl. The horses jumped about and reared, and we kept on ascending. Suddenly, I was conscious of the fact that the driver was in the act of pulling up the horses in the courtyard of a vast ruined castle, from whose tall black windows came no ray of light. Kind of a place had I come to? And among what kind of people? I heard a heavy step approaching behind the great door and saw through the chinks the gleam of a coming light. Then there was the sound of rattling chains and the clanking of massive bolts drawn back. A key was turned with the loud grating noise of long disuse, and the great door swung back. Within stood a tall old man, clad in black from head to foot, without a single speck of color about him anywhere. The old man motioned me in with his right hand with a courtly gesture, saying in excellent English but with a strange intonation, "Welcome to my house. Enter freely and of your own will." He made no motion of stepping to meet me, but stood like a statue, as though his gesture of welcome had fixed him into stone. The instant, however, that I had stepped over the threshold, he moved impulsively forward. I said interrogatively, "Count Dracula?" He bowed in a courtly gesture as he replied, "I am Dracula. I bid you welcome. It is late and my people are not available. Let me see to your comfort myself." Well, from your expression, I can see that Dracula still isn't real to you. Well, can you begin to believe? Can you imagine, for instance, that Bram Stoker's Castle Dracula might have existed? Well, it did. To ensure the strength of his reign, once and for all, Dracula used Easter, the most sacred of Orthodox holidays, as a trap. He encouraged a festive gathering of nobles and peasants on Easter morning, and then surrounded and captured them all. The old and sick were impaled and placed like fence posts around the city, while the young, healthy citizens were taken, still in their Easter costumes, and forced to work on the construction of Castle Dracula. They were fed as little as possible and worked until the clothes fell off their backs. No one knows how many years the construction took. No one knows how many died. He had built a perfect retreat closer to Transylvania, in a difficult spot to attack. Deep in the Carpathian Mountains, perched securely on a lofty crag, lies Castle Dracula. Today it stands in ruin, silent save for the moaning wind that echoes through its silhouetted majesty. One can only imagine the height of its battlements and the depth of its secrets. Oh yes, Castle Dracula was real, and to the Transylvanians, so were vampires. The ornate frescoes on these old Transylvanian church walls tell the story of vampirism. According to tradition, should a man change his religion from Eastern Orthodox to Roman Catholicism, as Vlad Dracula did, he was excommunicated and upon death became a vampire. These drawings are vivid in detail, depicting the restless souls of the undead rising out of their graves. So, the legend has some basis in fact. The potential of such rich drama was quickly discovered by a young, booming film industry, both in Europe and Hollywood. The Dracula legend found new life in 1922 with the release of a German film entitled Nosferatu. Now, director Friedrich Murnau unfortunately could not secure the necessary copyrights from Mr. Stoker, so he changed things slightly. Transylvania became the Baltic States, Count Dracula became Count Orlok, but essentially Nosferatu was the first of over 200 movies to contribute to Dracula lore. I have a copy of the film ready in the viewing room. Would you care to have a look at Dracula's first starring role? Oh, good. They just don't make them like this anymore.
And it's a good thing, too.
Is Max Schreck. His Count Orlok bears little resemblance to the elegant devils of later Hollywood and London versions. Though vampire stories had been translated to the screen as early as 1909, this film was an adaptation of Stoker's novel and is considered the first Dracula vampire movie. Even today, Nosferatu remains a masterpiece of horror. I just love a good romance. Kind of brings a lump to the throat, doesn't it? But the story gets better with every telling, as each element is added to the tale. The fangs, the black silk cape, the hypnotic eyes, even the myth that a vampire casts no reflection in a mirror. The vampire Dracula is a development of the ancient legends, and it's surprising how many similarities exist between the blood-sucking undead of Dracula's time and the modern fictionalized vampire of today. There are the common well-known myths, of course. Should one wish to remain totally prepared in case of vampire attack, I have assembled a small vampire emergency kit. Oh, yes, ma'am. Here is the first item, garlic. And pungent it is. The mere presence of this deliciously smelly herb will keep away the vampire, and for that matter, anyone else except a very dedicated apprentice chef. Now, the Transylvanians used to smear the fresh-cut cloves of garlic about their doorways and window sashes. The cross, of course, has always been the absolute power over vampires. Its shape has defended many a film star from the fangs of Dracula. And here is the traditional wooden stake. Though it may seem to be a movie cliche, the wooden stake has more than a literary association with vampires, as I will later explain. Now, here are two tiny little bandages, just the right size. Guess you know what they're for. Now, this is something you may not have seen. It is a small replica of a towaka. The real thing is much bigger, of course, and when struck, the very sound of it scares off every vampire within hearing distance. Now, I'm no expert, of course, so perhaps a proper demonstration would be in order. In Romania, the sounding of the towaka is a ritual performed by the priests several times each day. Now, should you not succeed in scaring off the vampire, you must certainly destroy it at the earliest opportunity. There are specific instructions as to how to accomplish this. They are given in Romanian, so please allow me to translate. We bury the vampires away outside the village, up in the mountains, by themselves, or at a crossroads far away from here. Nobody is safe from the vampire. So whenever strange things happen, you suspect right away that it's a vampire. The first thing to do is to go out and look at the graves in the cemetery. You look for freshly turned dirt or some other sign that a grave has been disturbed. You have to do this during the day. Vampires aren't dangerous during the day, only at night. That's when they come out to suck people's blood and make them sick and put a curse on people. So you go out to the cemetery in the daytime. If you see signs, you have to open up the grave and kill them. In some places, they kill a vampire by cutting off its head. The surest way to kill a vampire is by driving a stake through his heart. The stake has to be driven right through the vampire's body into the ground. But if you don't find him and kill him, he remains undead. Vampires are no quaint legend, nor is Dracula a theatrical character created through actors and special effects, no. He is terribly real. Certainly Hollywood has contributed much to the Western image of the Count. Many great men have played Dracula on the stage and screen. Most of them were my friends, though I somehow never had the opportunity to play the King of Evil. Maybe it's just as well. There are many classic film portrayals which have mixed fact with fantasy to create the popular image of Count Dracula. Many vampire movies have featured female vampires, but none compares with The Nightmarish Vampire, directed by Carl Dreyer in 1932. In this artistically acclaimed film, Dreyer presents his vampire as an ugly, old, witch-like woman. The horror is further enhanced by Dreyer's imaginative use of the camera. Such techniques as shooting through gauze to create a dreamlike haze are still used by filmmakers to this day. This 1936 Dracula sequel, Mark of the Vampire, incorporated all the classic elements. The spooky castle, the cobwebs, the dim candlelight, the eerie music, the pretty young girl, and of course, the most famous of all the Hollywood Draculas, Bela Lugosi.
By day, the vampires must return to the ground in which they were buried, or else find shelter in some accursed retreat. It is then they are powerless.
Then we must leave at daybreak. It's our chance to get away from here.
What? And leave these monsters here to continue their work of destruction? It would be cowardice.
What else is there to do?
Search for them. Find their corpse-like bodies. It is in that state, and that state only, they can be destroyed. Their heads must be severed with one clean stroke and a sprig of bat thorn placed within the gaping wound.
They would be crazy to attempt what you are planning. I'll never do it. Never. In the morning, they're leaving.
I agree with you.
Mark of the Vampire starred some very famous actors. Yes, that is Lionel Barrymore.
In 3 hours, it will be daylight. Thank heaven the house is well protected for the night.
Ah, the classic Dracula pose, but not the classic ending.
This vampire business has given me a great idea for a new act. Luna, in this new act, I will be the vampire. Did you watch me? I gave all of me. I was greater than any real vampire.
Sure, sure. But get off your makeup.
Yes, and help me with some of this packing.
They had to shove this breaky job onto me.
As the film industry progressed, so did the vampire story. In this 1943 production, Return of the Vampire, Bela Lugosi played a vampire who had been buried in London and was brought back to life by a World War II air raid.
There's a blasted spike sticking out of his chest.
You know, it ain't right for a man to be buried decent and proper-like and then go and get hurt by a blooming bomb splint. That spike's got to come out before we bury him again. Yes. Pull it out yourself.
Chicken-hearted is what you are. Oh. What's that?
Come on, Otis. Let's bury him and get it over with.
With his lifelong servant, a werewolf named Andreas, Lugosi plotted his steps towards immortality.
Lady Jane Ainslie and Professor Walter Saunders imprisoned me, deprived me of life for the past 23 years. It was my curse.
Posing as an escaped German doctor, the vampire chose his victim carefully.
For Lady Jane.
How will you do it, Master?
Through those she loves the most. Come, Andreas. I must find a new resting place. There you will bring the coffin with my native soil. And then, Andreas, I have other plans.
And well, you can guess the rest.
I've seen sick men before. Now, I know about men.
Perhaps the most unwilling vampire in film history was John Beale as Dr. Beecher in the 1957 movie simply entitled The Vampire.
You told me yourself these pills were from vampire bats.
Exactly, but Paul, that doesn't make you another Dracula. You found a strong suggestive influence there, that's all.
You think so?
It's my opinion you need a complete rest.
Well, you're wrong, Will.
Look, Paul, people depend on you here. I don't want to see you destroy your life. It's a useful life, Paul. I don't want to see you destroy it over an hallucination like this.
No hallucination.
But suppose it is. Look, suppose you confessed to that killing last night. Paul, you'll never be able to pick up your work here again. It's a small town, Paul. It's a small town. People...
Delving into the world of science fiction rather than straight horror, The Vampire tells the story of a doctor who unintentionally takes vampire pills.
11?
Yeah. That seems to be the hour. That's as long as I can go without the pills.
Now, nonsense. All right, Paul, I'll keep you from taking the pills. Now, you can trust me. I'll stay with you until 11 o'clock.
So I'm right. There is a killer. How'd he do it?
Well, it seems that this maniac extracts a small amount of blood from his victim's throats. And then, because he carries the disease virus in his saliva, he transmits it to them. But for some reason, he remains immune himself.
Oh, come on, Will. Help me. I gotta have him. I can't do it. I can't wait like this. Can't you see what's happening to me?
I can't see any different except your state of mind. Now, try to bear it just a little longer.
Oh, I can't. You gotta help me.
Look, I'm gonna give you the sedative, Paul, in just a few minutes.
I need it now. Please. Please. Oh, please.
Doomed to taking lives by night and saving them by day. Ah, the dramatic irony. Having accidentally attained immortality, this pathetic character wants more than anything to die and to end his nightmare. In 1961, actor Francis Lederer had his chance to portray the Prince of Darkness in Curse of Dracula, also called Return of Dracula. This time, the vampire comes to America for his evil pursuits. Using the name of Balak Gordal, he presents himself to the unsuspecting family of Cora Mabry, claiming that he is her long-lost cousin from Eastern Europe.
The cross is my enemy, Rachel. Take it off. Take off the cross, Rachel, then we can speak. I must speak with you.
What?
The cross. You will do as I say.
Obviously influenced by Bela Lugosi, Lederer is careful not to carry the resemblance too far, choosing a simple dark business suit for his vampire attire.
Are you afraid?
No.
I bring you the darkness of centuries past and centuries to come. Eternal life and eternal death. Now do you fear?
Get up, will you, Rachel? Gotta help Mom finish making the costume.
Out of the way.
No. No, you must listen to me. You must listen to what I say. You shall not leave. You are bound to me. You shall die as you are bidden to die.
Get out of the way!
Yes!
gone.
Ah, the imagination of the filmmaker. And who better in this age of cinematic miracles to perpetuate the evils of Vlad Dracula? But in this, as in all things, truth is stranger than fiction. From Bram Stoker down to today's characterizations of the prince, none has ever succeeded in even approaching the horrible truth of Vlad the Impaler. Even our most famous portrayals of Dracula fall short of the terror expressed in a 15th century portrait of the real Vlad Dracula. The artist is unknown, and so is his fate. Now you know what captured Bram Stoker's imagination. You understand the significance of Dracula and the wooden stake. Why little children in Romania are warned to be good, or Dracula will get them. Much more influential than the threat that Santa might not bring a gift, don't you think? But there is much more you don't yet understand, more strange truths you have yet to hear. What could be stranger than the truth of Dracula's past, Dracula's present? To the people of Romania, still isolated from the modern world, Dracula and his legend live on. The stories play an important part in their lives. You see, my friend, Dracula does exist today. Where? Where else? In Transylvania. You seem to scoff at the truth. I beg you, do not leap to conclusions until you have heard the whole story. For stranger things are still to come. Come to a remote village in the Carpathian Mountains of Transylvania. Not 15th century Transylvania, when Vlad Dracula led his bloodthirsty raids, but Transylvania today, where his legend still lives on. A man has died. His body lies in state in his home, awaiting the funeral tomorrow morning. And outside, the villagers have gathered to perform an exorcism, an age-old ritual complete with wailing and fires and homemade masks to ward off evil, to ward off the vampires. To these villagers, this is a serious, one could say, life or death matter. If they succeed, the soul of their friend will leave his body and rise to heaven. If not, he could become a vampire, joining the great undead, destined to return and promote evil in their community. One double-sided mask shows the effigy of the historical decapitated Dracula on one side and the traditional vampire with hollow eyes, pale skin, and bloodied mouth on the other. Dracula, the great undead.
Oh!
By the first light of morning, fear dwindles, but not precaution. Every care is taken to prepare the man's grave properly. In the graveyard, markers tell the story of how others in the village died. Here we see how this shepherd was murdered and then decapitated so that the victim could never come back to haunt his murderer. Such traditions still prevail. To these people, there is no greater fear than the fear of the undead returning. A hole is cut in the sheet covering the corpse. The lid of the wedge-shaped coffin is carefully laid on top, but no nails hold it in place. The grave is shallow.
Al Sfântului Duh, acum și bunurile și în vecii vecilor. Amin.
These procedures make it easier for the villagers to detect any signs of unnatural life. Should anything around the grave be disturbed, they will see it and react accordingly. One can never be sure. Despite the greatest precautions, a person may be destined to become a vampire. And so it is that these creatures lurk in the villages of Romania, or so the peasants believe. And that's why their ritual extends past the cemetery into their daily life. As everyone knows, vampires hate garlic. So all that is precious to these people is protected by this herb. The livestock, and of course, the home. All possible entrances are covered. The windows and doors, even the chimney, and keyholes. One can't be too well protected. The ceremonial mask reveals the two faces of Dracula, uniting two legends, the hero of Romania, the crusader, and the vampire, the great undead. Silly superstitions? Well, many have thought so. And many have attempted to disprove the legends through more practical and physical evidence of the life of Dracula. As you have seen, the historical proof of the existence of this prince of blood has served mostly to substantiate the legend of evil. And as every detail is unearthed, each seems to match a portion of the legend. Perhaps the most astounding evidence was supplied by an archaeological expedition mounted in 1936. In that year, scientists traveled to Transylvania, to the monastery of Snagov, to Vlad Dracula's grave, in search of the final truth. Today, Snagov is a gloomy place with only traces of its 15th century magnificence. Rich in legend, there are peasants here who say they've seen the ghost of Dracula rising from the lake. Who knows how many prayers and prisoners, famous people and infamous acts these walls have witnessed through the centuries? Who knows how many secrets lie buried here? Professor Dino Rossetti was among the scientists who made that pilgrimage in 1936 here to Snagov. To this day, he is reluctant to discuss his findings. More than 40 years have passed since I conducted my archaeological work here at Snagov. Tradition said that the grave of Dracula, the grave of Vlad the Impaler, was located here. Here in this part of the monastery, I had the opportunity to examine the grave. There was nothing to indicate that the grave had been disturbed or profaned. When the grave and the coffin were opened, I found that the clothing was well preserved and in quite good condition.
brun.
A red silk garment with the arms folded across the chest, but to our absolute amazement, the body had completely disappeared from inside the clothes. Only the clothing was there, without a trace of the body.
Where is the body of Dracula? The body of the Impaler? The body of the great undead?
Truth is an interpretation of facts, whether those facts be real or imagined. To the people of Romania, for the past 500 years, Vlad Dracula has existed as truth. The horrors of history lend credence to his legend. The people meld vampires, demons, and religious beliefs with the legend. The novelist mixes these elements with a fertile imagination and a dramatic flair, et voilà, Count Dracula, in all his glory. The prince's psychotic, twisted mind served a purpose for the people of Romania against the Turks. And his evil proves to be barbaric only in the light of the knowledge of successive generations. Well, I've told you the facts. It is up to each of you to interpret these facts and determine your own truth.
Well, it's dawn already.
How the time has flown. Well, I've enjoyed this evening very much. But I'm afraid our little chat must come to an end. Oh, Brimstoke should be back by now. He will show you out.
Good morning.
The spirit of a sorcerer or a witch.
Still to come, witches. Are they wicked or just misunderstood?
We're not green. Most of us do not cackle, so therefore we're difficult to recognize.
Also, the real Dracula. He may be more frightening than you've ever imagined.
We tried to make our Heinz homestyle gravy just like...
Beware of witches, or so we're told. They're wicked, they're treacherous, they're deceitful,
and they're also great fun. What would Halloween be without a witch? Or can you imagine Hansel and Gretel without one? All you'd have left is two kids and some breadcrumbs. And yet, the witch has been a source of ridicule for centuries. Folklore and legend have saddled her with very dark and sinister attributes.
She's usually depicted as an ugly old hag with a wart on her nose. No wonder she stayed home until after dark. She'd emerge at midnight, the witching hour, riding her broomstick across the sky. Now, it may be difficult to imagine, but this had to be even more uncomfortable than flying coach. But there was a purpose to her discomfort. She could use the broom to sweep her tracks from the sky. Her fashion sense, however, was not as discreet. She took to wearing large pointed hats, a dead giveaway that she was evil. You see, in earlier times, this style of hat was frowned on by the church, which equated the point with the horn of a devil. So anyone wearing such a hat would, of course, be in league with the devil. In spite of all the negative stereotypes that folklore has heaped on the witch, there is a large and growing number of people today who are proud to call themselves witches. They practice a pagan religion called Wicca, from the old English word for wise. Wiccan priestess Selena Fox explains.
Witchcraft is not only alive and well in the United States, but it is around the world. And by witchcraft, I mean the ancient nature religion. The word witch has a lot of baggage. One of the things that people think about when they hear the word witch is evil of some sort. We do not worship Satan. We don't believe in Satan. The idea of witchcraft and Satanism becoming synonymous is a result of the negative PR campaign that was done during the Middle Ages.
For several hundred years, a witch hysteria swept throughout Europe that cost thousands of innocent people their lives. It was a period in history the witches call the burning times.
It was the time where reason was thrown out the window. If someone happened to not be popular in a community, or if someone wanted their land, all one had to do was make an accusation that the person was a witch, and the trouble would begin for that person.
Once someone was accused, they went through a series of intense interrogations.
Woman, stand up.
Now tell me, Agnes, do you know John Bell?
Yes.
Torture was commonly used during these interrogations. People were tortured until they either gave up or died.
You spin well.
So,
we must find the mark. We must find the mark.
And when they gave up, they were forced to sign confessions that they had participated in black witchcraft and devil worship.
Woman!
I said, did you?
People lost their lands. People would rot in prisons for years, were hung or stoned to death. People were burned alive at the stake.
Some claim the men and women burning the witches were actually saving the souls of the convicted sinners.
People that called themselves Christian did some very unchristian-like things. Instead of loving their neighbor as themselves, they exterminated their neighbors, all in the name of eradicating evil. Hundreds of thousands, and some say even millions of people died during this rampage.
All from the fear of witchcraft. But the hysteria wasn't confined to Europe alone. In 1692, it found its way across the Atlantic to the small settlement of Salem, Massachusetts. It began in a kitchen where some young girls and a cook were playing with magic.
What do you see?
What happened next is a mystery that ended in tragedy.
In January of 1692, a little girl named Betty Paris became ill. She was the daughter of the minister of Salem Village. Before long, her cousin, Abigail Williams, who lived in the house with her, became ill as well.
Doctor, what ails them?
Reverend Paris called in a doctor. The doctor examined the young girls and, having no medical explanation for their illness, declared that they had been bewitched.
The thing to do then was to find out who was doing the bewitching,
punish those people, and all would be well.
At first, the girls refused to name the people who were supposedly bewitching them. But eventually, and most likely out of fear that their own experiments with magic would be discovered, the frightened youngsters began to name names.
Having committed sundry acts of witchcraft and sorcery.
And the Salem witch trials were off and running.
It was a time of terrible fear, because it was likely that if you defended somebody or spoke for somebody who was accused, you would be accused yourself. It was a time of great courage as well, because many of the people that were accused refused to confess to something that they hadn't done and went to their deaths with enormous dignity.
Confess now to God Almighty of your sins. You are a witch.
You are a liar. I'm no more a witch than you are a wizard.
Before it was over, 141 people would be arrested, and 20 would be put to death on what is now called Gallows Hill.
Whether or not the people who died on Gallows Hill were actually witches will never be known. In fact, it's very possible there were no witches in Salem at all at that time. But the same can't be said about today, for Salem has become a mecca for witches. And one of the most visible is Laurie Cabot.
There are 4,000 witches in Salem today, and we do rituals on Gallows Hill. If someone stumbled upon our ritual in the forest, they might be frightened because not many people have seen a witch's ritual or understand that it's a nature religion.
A very important part of most witchcraft rituals is the creation of sacred space. This typically takes the form of casting a circle.
And we bless Mother Earth.
The witch's pointed hat represents the sacred circle in which rituals are done. There are certain basic tools that witches use. The pentacle, incense, often in a cauldron. The cauldron for witches throughout Europe during the Middle Ages and before was used as part of folk healing. The old wise women who did the healing for their villages also had brooms, and some say that during the burning times that the broom was a way of concealing the witch's staff that was used in the casting of magic circles.
I've cast spells just like other people pray.
And we raise the cone of power.
To heal someone, to have someone have a prosperous life, for happiness.
And we bless.
I think many religions use their prayers and their magic to manipulate the world and people around them. That is harmful magic.
We ask for clean air, clean water.
Witches do not cast evil spells. Witches do not try to control other people. Unfortunately, some people hear the word witch and immediately think the worst.
For many years, the image that came to mind was that they flew on brooms and they were frightening. But what we're trying to do is help people to understand us so they don't need to fear us ever again. The future of witchcraft is as strong and as endless as our ancient history. Witches will never disappear from the earth.
And the world is a far more interesting place with them in it. Now, vampires, on the other hand, might not be as sorely missed, especially if they're real. Find out right after this.
Next, one man's incredible search for the real Dracula, plus modern-day vampires, murderers who have killed for blood. The image of the classic vampire has been greatly influenced by Bram Stoker's Dracula. black-caped count from Transylvania. A creature with fangs and a taste for blood. A monster that shuns the cross in the light of day. A diabolical fiend who can only be destroyed by a stake through the heart.
Fortunately for us, Count Dracula is only a fictional character. Or is he? Could this symbol of the living dead, a man who sleeps in his coffin by day and searches for blood by night, could this vampire have actually existed? It's a question that captured the imagination of one man, Dr. Raymond McNally, an historian who re-examined Stoker's novel with a detective's eye.
I noticed that the places were real. Transylvania is real. It's part of Romania. Many people still think Transylvania is made up somehow. It's not made up, it's real. And I had this intuition that if the author went to such pains to be correct, impeccably so, about those places, I bet he based that figure that he has in that novel upon somebody who existed. So I started asking Hungarian scholars, was there anybody like Dracula? Does the name mean anything to you? Could there have been such a person? And I reached a complete dead end. I was told, you're a fool. You won't find out anything. This is all folklore. It's a vampire story made up by the wild imagination of this author, Bram Stoker. Forget about it.
But Dr. McNally couldn't forget about it. The prospect of discovering the real Dracula was too intriguing. And so, he learned Romanian, and in 1972, he received a Fulbright Fellowship. Dr. McNally was finally on his way to Transylvania to hunt for a vampire.
I went in search of the real Dracula, and he turned out to be an extremely interesting, very sadistic kind of person.
McNally discovered his first clue at a 15th century home in the ancient Romanian city of Sighișoara.
There's a plaque at the house that says that Vlad Dracul lived here from 1431 to 1436. The father's name was Vlad Dracul, from the Order of the Dragon. The son is Vlad Dracula. The A in Romanian is like son of Dracul. So the connection with the Dracula that we know through the literature was clearly there. In the 15th century, this Dracula was a very well-known character. He was a horror figure already.
Armed with only a Super 8 movie camera, McNally followed the trail of Vlad Dracula through ransacked villages and desecrated monasteries. It was a bloody trail that eventually led him to the ruins of a medieval tower.
Cîntia Tower is a tower at Târgoviște, which is the old capital of Romania in medieval times. Now it is from that tower Dracula constructed a field called the Forest of the Impaled. Some 30,000 victims up on stakes and poles. Some of those victims had been up there for weeks. It's not a quick death. It's a terrible way to die. What is the purpose? That purpose is to show a lesson, a very powerful lesson.
Dr. McNally believes it was a graphic warning for the Turkish general Mohammed II, who was intent on destroying Dracula.
So the great conqueror, Mohammed II, when he came with his forces, outnumbering Dracula 3-1. But when he came to that field, the Forest of the Impaled, he said, what can you do against a man who does such terrible things? And he took his forces and he went home.
Dr. McNally had indeed discovered a monster, a titled aristocrat and military leader named Dracula. But was this Dracula merely a ruthless killer? Or was he actually a vampire, someone who drank blood?
One of the new discoveries show that Dracula liked to dine amid his impaled victims. Can you believe that? The stench must have been excruciating. And we have woodcuts, contemporary woodcuts, showing that. Anyway, he gathered the blood from his victims in bowls, and then he took bread and he dipped it in the blood and slurped it down. So he was, by anybody's definition, a living vampire.
When we return, a psychological condition that might actually turn people into vampires. And an interview with a woman who claims to be one. Witches, Werewolves, and Vampires will return in a moment.
Dr. McNally is convinced that he finally solved the mystery he'd read between the lines of Bram Stoker's novel, that the character of Dracula was based on a real person. But even if that's true, it isn't Vlad Dracula who springs to mind when you mention the word vampire. It's the character in books and movies that strikes terror in our hearts.
I believe that Dracula achieved his true immortality through the movies. And it's Nosferatu, that classic German movie. That's the best Dracula movie ever made, in my opinion. It launched the career of Dracula and made him immortal. Actually, the character in there looks like a vampire should look. It looks like the vampire of folklore, emaciated, ugly, disgusting in the extreme, and very, very scary. After all, it's a corpse. It's a walking corpse. It's been in the grave for a while. And that's the way it is in the folklore.
To understand the significance of this folklore, it's necessary to examine the attitude the medieval world held regarding death.
The assumption was that death came from the dead. In other words, if one person died and then a whole bunch of other people died, people assumed that the first person had brought death to the others. And typically what they did was dig up the corpse of the first person and inspect it for evidence that it was a vampire. For example, they would discover that the corpse would often have blood at its lips. The conclusion that they drew was that the reason why the corpse had blood at its lips and was larger than it had been was that it had been drinking the blood of the living.
Modern forensic science has provided a more rational explanation for this phenomenon. As a dead body decomposes, it creates gases which build up pressure in the lungs, forcing blood up through the mouth and onto the lips of the corpse. But without this medical knowledge, it's easy to understand how this natural process could be misinterpreted. And according to Dr. McNally, these superstitions and legends of the living dead survive in parts of Eastern Europe even today.
People in Transylvania still believe passionately in vampires, even though most of them have never seen a Dracula movie and they've never read the novel. I'll give you one example. When I was traveling, I met a girl whose father was a vampire. Yes. Tinka, her name. I said, "What do you mean your father was a vampire?" She said, "When he died, he was laid out to rest. And after 3 days, they noticed rigor mortis had not set in. The skin was still pliable. Cheeks bore a ruddy complexion. These are the signs of the vampire in that part of the world, the undead." So she told me, she couldn't do what had to be done because it was the body of her own father. But the villagers did, and they did what is done in the horror movies. They took a wooden stake and they plunged it through the heart of the corpse, keep it from walking. Got to drive it through the body and into the ground underneath the corpse. That's what pins it to the earth.
Legends surrounding the vampire have provided terrified villagers with additional methods to protect themselves against the myth of the living dead. One of their folk remedies came from the notion that anything already dead and buried probably wouldn't have an especially pleasant odor when it came back to life.
Vampires were known to have themselves a very strong smell. And there's an old expression in Latin, similia similiis curantur. Similar things are cured by similar things. This belief caused people to feel that if the vampire has a strong smell, then what you should do to ward the vampire off is to put things that have strong smells around you. Garlic would typically be hung up in areas where vampires could enter. For example, you might hang garlic around the windows. Other things that ward off vampires are anything that's sharp. So people would put knives under their pillows or to embroider roses around any opening in the clothing. And the assumption there is that roses have thorns, vampires don't like things that are sharp, and therefore these things will keep away the vampires.
While men like Dr. McNally and Paul Barber explored the myth in the vampire fiction and folklore and history, other experts turned their attention to the psychological and criminal side of vampirism. What they discovered, if true, is both fascinating and terrifying.
Researchers nowadays believe that in addition to the vampire as a figure of myth and legend, there are certain conditions that actually lead to people developing the craving to drink human blood. Now, when I'm talking about vampires in the modern context, obviously I'm not talking about people who are transforming themselves into bats. At least I've never seen it. What I'm talking about are people who develop the compulsion to drink human blood. There's a typical pattern in the evolution of this condition that's been dubbed Renfield syndrome, named after the blood-drinking psychotic character in Bram Stoker's Dracula. The first stage generally begins in childhood. Some kind of critical incident occurs where the young person, boy or girl, but usually a boy, discovers that drinking blood can be exciting. This can lead to a second stage of what is known as auto-vampirism, or the lust for one's own blood. That then can evolve to a third stage known as zoophagia. This involves the consumption of non-human animals in order to drink their blood. So watch out for your dogs and cats in the neighborhood. Vampires at this stage might grab pets. The most advanced stage of Renfield's syndrome is true vampirism, which involves the drinking of the blood of other human beings. Some people who have reached this stage sneak into hospitals and blood banks and try and steal blood from the storage there. This stage of Renfield's syndrome can develop into serial murder. These people actually take blood involuntarily from other human beings. I think the most notorious case in modern times of a serial murderer who apparently had Renfield syndrome, clinical vampirism, was the Haig case.
During the late 1940s, English newspapers recounted the bizarre tale of John George Haig,
and you'll understand
a dapper gentleman who became known as the London Vampire.
Oh.
Haig's victims were his friends, people who trusted him.
Don't go far.
He would lure them to an abandoned warehouse on the edge of town.
John?
They thought they were going to visit his place of business.
I can't see anything.
They didn't know
don't
they were going
worry.
To their debts.
I'm getting the light.
Oh, John, hurry. I really can't see.
Haig killed his victims quickly, usually with a gunshot to the back of the head. Reports suggest that Haig's obsession with blood began as a child. His parents frequently beat him, and one day, while being struck with a hairbrush, The bristles drew blood. He sucked the wound and enjoyed the taste. Like a classic case of Renfield syndrome, eventually his own blood couldn't satisfy him, and Haig began killing for a fresh supply. In addition to their blood, he also robbed his victims of their personal possessions, even going so far as to forge their names to gain access to their property. Haig confessed to killing 9 people over a period of several years before he was finally captured and convicted. John George Haig was executed for murder in 1949. Coming up, she sleeps in a coffin and drinks blood, but is she a vampire? The strange case of the London vampire sent shockwaves around the world nearly half a century ago.
John George Haig is not the only person considered to be a modern-day clinical vampire. Unfortunately, during the last 20 years, there have been numerous reports of other people who were so psychologically damaged, so criminally insane, that they actually acted upon the impulse to commit murder for blood.
New York, 1975. A woman is arrested for a grisly homicide that involved the siphoning of the victim's blood. California, 1978. Richard Trenton Chase is convicted of multiple murder, including at least one count of vampirism. His crimes earn him the nickname the Vampire Killer. Massachusetts, 1980. A young man with a history of mental illness hears a voice that tells him to use bullets painted gold to kill for blood. Only then will he be able to become a vampire. Florida, 1985. A 19-year-old woman accepts a ride from a man named John Brennan Crutchley, a successful high-tech engineer, who, after his capture, is dubbed the vampire rapist. Minnesota, 1988. After watching a modern vampire film, 3 teenagers decide to act out a similar scenario. They confront a 30-year-old vagrant who is unable to defend himself from their attack.
Fascination with blood, and even with drinking blood, is not restricted to serious psychiatric cases. My sense is that there probably have always been people involved in this. And the reason is that the sight of blood is, I believe, naturally exciting. Why is it that traffic slows almost to a stop whenever there's an accident? Because people slow down and they're looking for the red stuff. That orientation toward blood may well be programmed in the human being, because in the settings within which our species evolved, the sight of spilled blood indicates danger, indicates the presence of threat. Now, one of the properties of our species is that we can convert one type of physiological arousal, one type of being excited and turned on, into another type. For example, when we watch a horror movie, what is going on is that we're deliberately putting ourselves into a situation when we see monsters and often a lot of blood. We are being aroused by the fear stimuli, pressing those natural buttons inside ourselves. Another part of our mind, of course, knows that we're in a theater and we're safe. So we can convert the arousal of fear into the arousal of having a good time in a movie theater. So I think it's important, even though it may be kind of comforting, to distance ourselves from vampirism. I think perhaps it's not fully honest. I think that potentially there may be a vampire in all of us.
If not in all of us, there is a potential vampire in at least a small subculture of our society. People who believe, or say they believe, that they are vampires. I want you to meet Katrina Coffin.
I believe I'm a vampire because I do like the taste of blood, and I am nocturnal. I have a casket in my living room, and I do sleep in that. So if I've been up all night and the sun is coming up, I do not like the sun, and I can get into my casket, close the lid, and that way I don't have to deal with the sun or noise, and it's very comfortable and it's easy to sleep in. I drive a 1968 Cadillac hearse. I have a coffin in the back of my car for decoration. I'm very into the macabre. I have a lot of horror memorabilia around my house, and bats and rats and skulls and such. I have quite a few exotic animals. I like snakes, and I have a couple of tarantulas and a scorpion. I love the theatrics of vampirism. I like wearing the dark makeup. I like long fingernails. These are my real nails. And I've always been this way. When I was a child, if a friend of mine would fall and cut themselves, I would take the blood from the wound. And kids were kind of fascinated by it. They thought it was interesting. I don't bite people in the neck. Biting just leaves bruises. It doesn't draw blood. I don't need blood to survive, whereas someone like Dracula would have to have blood. I don't like the sun, but I won't disintegrate if I go out in it. I think there could be somewhere vampires that really are immortal, that live forever, need blood to survive. It's possible. There are ghosts and all types of other things, so anything is possible.
In every major city, I suspect that you could find interest in drinking blood, and I wouldn't necessarily want to say that that's the same thing as a psychiatric disorder. Having said that, however, a word of advice, drinking blood from your partner is not a safe sex practice. So I think a health advisory, don't bite your friends. You could acquire dangerous diseases.
Witches, werewolves, and vampires, are they real? Well, as we've discovered tonight, that's a question that has no easy answer. The myths and legends of these creatures have been handed down through time. They were created by people who needed to put a face on their fears, to find answers to mysteries that have no explanation, and to evaluate the good in their lives against a specter of evil. Today, we no longer need these mythological monsters to explain the evil in our world, but the fascination with them lives on. People of all ages continue to thrill to a good horror story. As long as the sun sets, the moon rises, and night turns the sky to black, witches will fly on their broomsticks, werewolves will howl at the moon, and vampires will rise from their graves.
And we will be there enjoying every moment of danger and suspense. Thank you for joining me tonight on our search for the unexplained. I'm Peter Graves. Good night.
You've been watching The Unexplained in 2 weeks.